We like to think that we are changing the world one forum at a time, and today we're going to talk about a very substantive topic, one that's been on the minds and hearts of everyone in Michigan. And I am going to not be the one to introduce our illustrious speaker. I'm going to have State Representative Stephanie Chang from the 6th District. She covers part of Detroit, Wilkerson, Romulus. She's on the Education Reform Committee, so this is especially interesting to Representative Chang. But you know, one of the best things is that she is an alum, three times over, of the University of Michigan. Representative Stephanie Chang.
Well, thank you so much, and thank you for inviting me to be here with you today. So actually, well, a good friend of mine, Amanda Rossman, used to work for our speaker, and she always had really wonderful things to say about her. So it's a pleasure to finally meet you. So again, my name is Stephanie Chang. I'm the state representative from House District 6, and I served on the House Education Committee last term. I'm serving on the House Education Reform Committee this term. And, you know, I think that we're all very passionate about education issues, especially in the city of Detroit. Obviously, it's been a subject of conversation here in the legislature, and I think will continue to be. And so, very honored to introduce our speaker. Dr. Elizabeth Moje is the George Herbert Mead Collegiate Professor of Education, third professor. And Dean of the School of Education at the University of Michigan. She began her career teaching history, biology, and drama at high schools in Colorado and Michigan. And she uses an array of methods to study and support young people's literacy learning in Detroit, Michigan. She's particularly interested in the intersections between disciplinary literacies of school and the literacy practices of youth outside school studies, how youth draw from home, community, ethnic, popular, and school cultures to make cultures and to enact identities. In 2010, she was awarded the Provost Teaching Innovation Prize at the University of Michigan. So happy that you're here, and we look forward to hearing your remarks.
Great, thank you. Do you think you can hear me without a mic? So that I don't have to stand back there, partly because I can't see my slides if I stand back there. And, you know how that is when you're going along and you think something's on the screen and it's actually something different. It's sort of embarrassing. I wanted to say thank you to all of you for coming here today. I assume that you're here because you care as much about Detroit education as I do, and that makes me very happy. And in general, that you care about education, education reform, and improvement. I think that this is probably the most critical issue in our society today. But of course I would think that, right? Because I'm a dean of a school of education, I've devoted my entire life to education, but I actually think that many of you would agree with me that we need to do a better job in general of educating our children and youth, and when I say youth, I mean also through the college years. And in fact, of providing continuous adult education as well for all our citizens. Because we know that our world is rapidly changing and that people often have to retool, they have to learn new skills, and we need to just get better at educating people. So that's my pitch for education as a subject of concern, and I thank you all for being here. I thought I would start by telling you just a little bit about myself, so that you would know something about my commitments, my passions, and then I'll turn to talking about, very briefly, our School of Education, and then lead into the work that we're doing in Detroit. So, as you heard Stephanie say, I started my career as a high school history and biology teacher. It was a double major, and on the side, I did theater, so I also became the drama director. I also coached cheerleaders. So I really learned, you know, sort of the gamut of the life of a high schooler. And I learned a lot from my students because I saw them in many different settings. And learning about them outside of school, as well as in school, and even from one context like a history class to another context like a biology class, taught me that they have different skills and passions and proficiencies that they exhibit differently in those contexts. Part of my work in coaching cheerleaders was driving a school bus because, yes, I know, I drove a school bus, because the cheerleaders were not allowed to ride in the same bus as the players, the male players and the cheerleaders. And so I would drive these kids around. I also did a traveling children's theater and drove kids around the city of Detroit. We taught in Farmington Hills, but we would go all over the city to go to our different events. And sometimes I couldn't find my way home because I was actually living in Ann Arbor and commuting. And I didn't know all of the parts of Detroit, which, as many of you know, is a massive city. It's one of our largest cities geographically in this country. And so the students, my students, would have to help me get home. And that turning the tables really taught me that we have to learn from our students and we have to respect all the different skills that they bring to us. And then we have to use those skills to help them build new skills and new proficiencies. So that's my background and my commitment. I, as a researcher, I am an ethnographer by training. That means that I study culture, and in particular, I study youth culture. And I try to understand how literacy is developed and practiced by young people in all of their different cultures, whether it's their home culture, their ethnic and national cultures, their school cultures, whether it's biology class culture or history class culture. I try to understand how they're using those skills as they move across the landscape. And since coming back to Michigan, and by the way, I'm a Michigander. I'm from Bay City originally. So anybody know of the Bay City area? The thumb? Yeah. All right. Good. You're my new friend. I came back to Michigan and really have been doing all of my research in Detroit since then. So that was 1997. I've been there 20 years. I've been at the university 20 years. And I have been working as hard as I can to try to contribute to the improvement of educational opportunity for young people in the city of Detroit since that time. So, the School of Education. I'm new to the deanship, but I'm not new to the school, obviously. I came in 97. I served as a faculty member, moved up through the ranks. And then I became the Associate Dean for Research and Community Engagement. And that was a wonderful opportunity to really build on my passion and my work in Detroit, to try to move from being the individual researcher and professional developer to bringing our school into a stronger and more obvious relationship with Detroit. Our school has two central commitments. One is the study and improvement of education practice, policy, and the context of teaching and learning. The second is the education of practitioners, including teachers, leaders, higher educators, and also researchers, those who might contribute to reforming education. I'm adding a third focus to the school's mission. It's not separate from those two foci, but I'm adding the focus of public scholarship. I think that as a school, we can do a better job of translating our research and our professional development work and our work with young teachers and young leaders into actual context. And so we're committing ourselves to very deep partnerships. We have a very stable and robust partnership with Ann Arbor Public Schools. It's lasted through three superintendents. And we have a developing partnership with Detroit Public Schools, now Detroit Public Schools Community District.
It has lasted through 5 emergency managers and is continuing. We are not giving up. It is a partnership. It is a memorialized partnership. We have actual paperwork to represent our relationship. But as you can imagine, it does go up and down with the changes in leadership. And that's one of the things that I'll be talking about as I talk about our work. Through developing that partnership, I've come to believe that we need to do one thing in reforming Detroit education and in thinking about reforming education writ large. Not only one thing, of course, but one thing has to happen to make sure that all the other necessary ingredients will take hold. And that is, we need to collaborate more effectively, more comprehensively, and more deliberately. And I'm going to try to talk about that and share with you an idea that I have that I'm launching to try to make that difference in Detroit. So I'm going to use Detroit as a case for all urban education. So when I was asked to give this talk, I was asked to speak about urban education reform in particular, and really to focus in on our work in Detroit. But I'm not just focusing on the Detroit work because I was asked to do so. I think it actually represents an excellent case of thinking about urban reform, urban education reform. I think that Detroit is much like many other cities in the United States, cities like St. Louis and Baltimore, and Philly, Chicago, but Detroit may have gotten where it is sooner than some other cities. And so if we are able to do what I'm proposing, what we've been working on in this talk, I think we can provide a model, not only for our state, but for the entire United States in thinking about urban education reform. And I'm going to be drawing from lessons learned, actually, in the Consortium on Chicago Schools. Are any of you familiar with the consortium's work? So you'll hear some threads that are similar with one, I think, essential difference. So I'm going to start, how many of you are really deeply familiar with Detroit? Obviously Stephanie is. Okay. I'm going to start though just to get a lay of the land, and I'm characterizing this as a tale of two cities. So when we talk about Detroit education, we often hear, and here's where I'm going to check and make sure, yeah, my slides did what I wanted them to do. We often hear about things like massive deficit, the struggles around state control, teacher shortages, sick buildings. We all lived through that, you know, really unfortunate, very public representation of our Detroit school buildings in the national news, and sick outs, right? Teachers who are really, I would argue, so fed up and so frustrated that they use a sick out to really represent their concerns. I want to paint a different picture of Detroit, the Detroit that I know from 20 years of working there. I want to talk about engaged children and youth, caring families, and really dedicated and thoughtful teachers. And that is in direct contrast to some of the negative portrayals that we see in the media, and it may even be in direct contrast to some of your experiences. And I understand that, and I understand, having been through working in Detroit for 20 years, that there are times when it can feel really frustrating and really hard, and in some cases, hopeless. But I want to argue that there's great hope, that when you look in the eyes of those children and those young people, we see great hope. When you talk to parents who really want the best for their children but may not be able to always provide it, we see great hope. And when we talk with teachers, some of whom have been in that city teaching for 20 and 30 years, when they could have gone elsewhere, we see great hope. So that's what I want to try to keep in your minds today as we talk about what we need to do to try to reform Detroit education. Because even though there is a tale of two cities, we know that we're not doing our best to educate children in that city. All right. So with all of that, if I'm saying there's great hope and we have all of these wonderful ingredients, Why isn't it better? What do we need to do to really improve Detroit education? And this is where you'll see some hints for those of you who are familiar, sorry, with the consortium's work, the Chicago Schools Consortium's work. You'll see some of the things that we need to work on. So first of all, we need ambitious teaching. That's a phrase that many of us have adopted to try to think about the kind of instruction that doesn't say things like, oh, well, they didn't learn what they needed to know in first grade or in fifth grade or in 10th grade, so I can't do anything with them. But it's always ambitious. It's always working where children are and moving them forward. To do that, obviously, we need great teachers, and I'm a teacher educator, so that's going to be number one on my list. But we know from the research that great instruction, ambitious instruction, actually does make a difference. It can mediate effects of poverty, not by itself, but it can have a huge impact. We do know, by the way, that children learn in school. We have the data that show that they actually are making progress. What we don't see is the closing of gaps between different groups of children that we should be able to see. So we need to work on that by helping to build really great teachers. We need great curriculum. It is really hard to teach well if you don't have adequate curriculum. And we need to work on some stability so that we don't have rotating curricula, so that every year or every 2 years or 3 years, teachers aren't having to learn new materials. And of course, those of you who work in, you know, in, well, many of you work in Lansing, those of you who work at the state level know that that also means we need to not continually change standards. Because if you change the standards, then of necessity you need to change the curricula. We also need to think about the fact that standards are not curricula. This is a big misconception. Even at the federal level, I was part of a group trying to work on a grant proposal to implement standards. Well, you can't implement standards. You can achieve standards. You have to implement instruction that works toward those standards. So we have to really think about that, that we can't just make standards, we also actually have to provide curricula that will help teachers. This is absolutely critical for young teachers. We work on this in our School of Education. We work with what we call starter units. Instead of asking our novice teachers to go out and build lessons from scratch, we provide them with starter units so that they can then make those units their own and make them work with the standards. But to simply expect people to create their own curriculum is incredibly naive, really, if we expect to see change. And then we need great tools. There is the suggestion that all our schools are wired, all our schools have great access to technology. But I have seen the wires in Detroit schools coming out of the wall, not attached to anything. I have seen the broken computers, the broken rows and rows of broken or dated technology tools. And we have to really think carefully about how we're going to ever bring people to equitable education if they don't have equitable tools. But this doesn't mean that I'm calling for iPods for everyone, or iPads, or whatever they're called, I mean, iPads, right? That is also a misconception, that we simply give people technology tools and the technology will teach them. So we need those three components tied together to build ambitious teaching. We obviously need robust and sustained opportunities to learn. I'm part of a group, a national group, working on time to learn and really thinking about how we might change the nature of the school calendar and the nature of the school day so that kids are in school longer but not doing, you know, remedial work. They're in school doing all of that engaged, enriched learning, and they're also distributing time across the year. We need to push ourselves on that. We need, more than anything probably, ambitious and systemic leadership. We know that great teachers matter, but great teachers can't be great teachers in shaky schools. They can't be great teachers when things are changing every time they turn around. So this is a key ingredient for us. we need community and parent engagement. So much of what we're struggling with in Detroit is that our parents feel left out of the conversation. And then they become, we have these two groups, or more than two groups, and they start to, I don't want to say fight because that sounds too aggressive, but the disagreements grow out of simply being two groups rather than actual disagreements of content. And then finally, we need continuous database improvement. And that is tied to ambitious and systemic leadership. You have to have leaders who can engage in that continuous improvement and who pull their ambitious teachers into it with them and the parents into it with them. All right, so those are ingredients. How do we bring those together? What are we doing in our School of Education to try to contribute to that? The first thing I'll say is that we're doing something on every one of those ingredients as different pieces. We have all sorts of faculty members working on every single one of those things in Detroit and beyond. That's great, but it's not comprehensive and it's not necessarily coordinated. What I would like to propose is that we think about how we coordinate and we build what I'm calling IDEA, Innovate Detroit Education Alliance, with a focus on the bold-faced word there, the alliance. In this IDEA, and you see my Detroit skyline in the background, the slide isn't very big, but that's the perfect logo. We would really like to try to work on building alliances with other higher education institutions, and I'll tell you about more about that in a minute, citizens and families, the government, in the local government and the state government, businesses, cultural organizations, and funders, to try to coordinate our efforts, to try to do a better job of making this ambitious work possible. In some cases, we find ourselves tripping over each other out in different schools in Detroit. We actually find ourselves tripping over each other in the same school. Meanwhile, other schools sit unattended. And that doesn't really mean that we're going to be able to produce a comprehensive kind of reform. So my argument is that if we're not pulling all of these groups together, we're not ever going to make the kind of change that we want to see. So here are some of the allies. I originally had collaborators, and then I thought, well, it's an alliance. These have to be allies that we are working with right now to try to do this work in Detroit. When I list these names, these are people we're partnering with. We don't have the entire infrastructure of IDEA built yet, but we're working on it. So on the U of M side, we have almost all of the schools and colleges at the University of Michigan working together with the School of Education. I shouldn't say that. They're not working together. In other words, engineering isn't working necessarily with the Ford School. Everyone's working with us in different kinds of partnership activities. And we're really trying to work on coordinating our efforts so that we're not tripping over each other. On the other side, we have our community allies, and this list continues to grow. And I want to emphasize that many of them are Detroit cultural organizations like the DIA, the Opera House, Detroit Symphony Orchestra. Some of them are youth-based organizations like Merit, which was started by a U of M graduate, David Merritt. Yeah, you're shaking your head, Veronica. He's an amazing guy. He started his own apparel company and then did a spin-off called Fate that educates young people in how to start and run businesses. So he takes them through all 4 years of high school, mentored by other U of M undergrads, to learn how to be entrepreneurs. Yes?
I notice you don't have the Board of Education up there. Is there a reason for that?
We don't have the Board of Education because until recently, the Board of Education was not locally elected. So
and they fought with each other when they were, so. I'm sorry.
All right, you said that, not me. That's on tape. But yeah, we definitely are in outreach mode so that we can start to build that relationship as well. That's a critical relationship. You notice I also don't have Detroit Public Schools Community District, and yet it is part of our partnership. It's definitely a key ingredient of our partnership. And then I wanted to point out the last three. Here I am in Spartan Country. I couldn't leave Michigan State off the list. But actually, we're just starting talks with Michigan State, Eastern Michigan, and Wayne State to really try to build an interinstitutional partnership that will allow us to stop working across each other or doing the same kinds of things and actually distribute our talents and expertise. One of the things that we've agreed on in our conversations is that although, you know, for example, the University of Michigan, we're the leaders and best, we actually aren't the leaders and best at everything. We can't do everything. And so we're trying to figure out, so what do you guys do really well? And what do, you know, what does Michigan State do really well? What does Eastern do really well? How could we partner across these different strengths and also fill in each other's gaps in the service of helping to improve Detroit education? All right, so what are the key areas of work? And again, these institutions, all of the ones you saw listed, can't do all of these things equally well. We have to divide up the tasks. But our key areas, are teacher support and development. And I would say that every one of our higher ed institutions is interested in doing that. And we'll all do it in different ways, which will allow us actually to learn from each other and to think about which ways, which of these approaches are most effective. So that's really exciting. We also need to do curriculum development, adaptation, and support. And I want to say about the first two, teacher support and development and curriculum development, we can do this in ways that will save the district money if we do this correctly. So if we pool our efforts, we can really offer these things simply at the cost of doing them, not making a profit like so many professional development organizations in particular do. So we really think this is also an economically feasible way to do the work. And at the same time, we're learning from it. Imagine us educating our teachers while also developing veteran teachers. That's a really exciting prospect. We also need to do a better job with youth support and development. I was in a meeting just a few days ago with our colleagues across the institutions and at DPSCD, talking about the fact that every one of our higher ed institutions has different groups out in the city doing different things for young people. That's fabulous, but again, it's not coordinated. So some young people are getting a lot of attention, or they might be getting a lot of FIRST Robotics, but other young people aren't getting any attention, or they're not getting dance or something like that, right? So we need to think about how we can distribute that youth support and development in more equitable ways, and also make sure that we're covering a whole spectrum of talents and skills that young people need to develop. And then finally, we can do work in systems and leadership development. We have just launched at Michigan the first Education MicroMasters certificate program. If you haven't heard about this and you're interested, I'll send you a link. What that means is that we're offering 5 MOOCs. Does everyone know what a MOOC is? Massive Open Online Course. That means that anyone can take these courses in continuous improvement science and education free. We have about 8,000 participants right now on our first MOOC, which is on ambitious instruction. And we're offering 5 of these. And if people take all 5 and pay for the certificates attached to each, it's a very low cost, they can get a MicroMasters certificate in education improvement and innovation from the University of Michigan. That also qualifies them to enter the residential master's degree or the full master's, the certified University of Michigan master's. So we're doing that work And so are many other higher education institutions. And again, we can partner on this together. So now I want to tell you about just a few, like drill down into some of the partnership activities that we're doing just with our units on campus. So this is not Michigan partnering with other institutions, but Michigan also building alliances across campus. So the first is Michigan ARC Prep. Has anybody heard of this? It's really innovative, started by the Taubman College of Architecture and Urban Planning. And they work in consultation with us, with the School of Education, because they know architecture, but they don't know 16-year-olds. And their goal is actually to teach architecture concepts, introductory concepts, to 16-year-old students in Detroit. They have pulled six schools, public high schools in Detroit, together. They persevered to get the leadership of DPSCD to bus six schools worth of students every day to a dedicated architecture studio, 5 days a week, all semester, for 3 hours, those kids take an architecture class. In that architecture class, they learn architecture, which means they learn math, they learn science, they learn art, they learn about spatial relationships, and they learn about college and careers. They bring in young architecture students to teach, and then we help them think about how you teach high school students. And they bring in practicing architects to work with the kids. And all of the kids produce a portfolio, and they also get counseling on how to prepare for college. So that's one example of a collaboration or an alliance that we developed, and really it was through Taubman's initiative. They came to us and said, we need help thinking about how to work in Detroit schools and how to work with young people. It's an amazing program, and we could do many more things like this. A second collaboration is with the College of Engineering, and this is my project, so I'm particularly fond of it. It's called Sensors in a Shoebox. We were the recipients of a Night Cities Challenge grant for Detroit. I don't know if you're familiar with the Night Cities Challenge, but this was awarded a small grant to do work with young people to use sensor technologies and face-to-face research tools like community surveys, community interviews, observation, to learn about problems in their city, to then work with data and understand solutions to problems, and then to make a case to city officials or to different organizations to try to address those problems. So we actually, after we won the Night Cities Challenge, we also received a grant from the National Science Foundation to develop this and actually do an application in school. So we have an after-school program currently running at Detroit Voyager College Prep in Southwest Detroit, with about only 15 students right now because it's a pilot. And then we'll be developing a summer school program, and then we'll try to expand that into science classrooms.
What are they sensing? I'm missing something.
Oh, I'm sorry. So what happens is that the young people actually decide what problems they think exist in their community. And then they we work with them to help them understand what sensor technology is, and we're working with engineers to do this. And then the students think about, well, what can I use a sensor? Which of those problems can I study using sensor technology? So some of the examples are air pollution, motivated by the fact that many of them have pretty severe asthma problems. And so this is very personal to them. And they also learn that they have to find out what the community cares about. What does the community want to know? Another kind of problem that they're studying is how to revitalize the city. So they look at things like pedestrian traffic, so use of space. And we can also study water quality. And we take them through all of the different pieces of how you would build sensors and where you would plant a sensor to be able to capture those data. At the same time, we're trying to help them understand that a sensor, while it can capture a lot of data, can't tell you much about the data. So, for example, if you're looking at park usage, you can find out that lots of people moved through the park, but you don't know who they are. Maybe they're people you don't want moving through the park. Maybe they're, you know, five-year-olds, which would be wonderful if they're moving through a park that has all sorts of play structures. If you're trying to revitalize your community and you want to build coffee shops or cool clubs, then you don't want five-year-olds to be your main users of the space, right? So we're actually trying to teach them how, really, it's about how to collect data and use the data to solve problems in your community. But in doing so, we're teaching them about engineering, we're teaching them about the limits of data, and we're getting them involved working side by side with urban planners, engineers, and educators. So they're seeing, again, some models of who they could be if they were to pursue this kind of work. The great thing about sensors in a shoebox is that we also are now very popular with a lot of the community organizations. So the Detroit Riverfront Conservancy has asked our kids to collect data for them. So it's a real project, like doing real work. And the health department is asking our kids to collect data for them. And we have some of the mayor's urban planners interested in having the kids collect data. So we decided that we would have these groups come in and pitch to the kids. And the kids get to decide which of the problems they want to work on, or maybe work on multiple problems. So hopefully what you can see here is through this kind of activity, they're building literacy skills, they're building science skills, they're building math skills, they're building engineering skills, and most important, I think, from my perspective, they're building a sense of agency, that they can actually make a difference in their community, that they should have a voice. And of course, it's a wonderful project to do, you know, with our engineering colleagues. A third partnership that we have, an alliance, is with the Detroit Public Schools Community District, and this is our Detroit School of Arts partnership. This has been a challenging partnership for us. We've been working on it since 2008. It has gone up and down, but we are there. We're doing all sorts of exciting work, and we have an enormous number of community partners in working in alliance with us. I could only list a few of them there. We have the Courage curriculum, which is something developed by Stephanie Warburg, another U of M alum. We have Urban Debate, we have the DIA, we have the Detroit Symphony Orchestra, you name it, Wayne State University, numerous partners. One of the really exciting things that we've done is we've built something called Jumpstart. And you notice in the far quadrant, the ART is capitalized because it's really about a jump start into high school. Detroit School of Arts is a high school, to try to help young people learn what it means to be a serious student of the arts. Not just somebody who likes to do arts, but somebody who's really a student, which means they also have to be a student of academics. And so we do all of this wonderful work in Jumpstart on math and art, science and art, English language arts and art, and the social sciences and the arts. We're hoping that, cross your fingers, that we can develop a summer program for 6th, 7th, and 8th grade students, particularly focused on instrumental music, because that's a huge challenge. If you don't have strong arts programs in your K-8 schools, then it's very hard for young people to pick up an instrument in 9th grade and learn it well. I always use the example of my own daughter when she was playing flute, learning to play flute, and she just really wasn't progressing. And she kept telling me stories about what this other girl would tell her about. And I said, how many classes do you have with Betty? And she said, oh, I just have band with her. And I said, well, how do you guys talk so much? And she said, well, you know, Mr. X has to work with the clarinets and then has to work with the trumpets and then has to write. So he's busy and he can't get to all of the kids. And so we sit for sometimes for half an hour. And that night, I called her piano teacher, who's also a flute teacher, and I said, we need private lessons in flute for my daughter. And we added private lessons. Not every parent can do that, right? So we're trying to think about ways that we could offer that kind of instruction. That's what I mean about extending opportunities to learn to all kids. Yes?
Are you taking questions or you want to wait for
me? Oh, yeah, please.
So are these are like little apprenticeship programs in a way. Are they, how do the students select into? Are they self-selected or are they apply? Or?
In Detroit School of Arts, that it's the children who would be coming to the high school. If we build the 6th, 7th, 8th grade program, then that would open up to all of the city of Detroit because DSA is an open enrollment school. It's an audition school, but it's an open enrollment. But think about that, too. Kids could have natural talent, but if they haven't had the training, it's harder to compete in an audition, right? So we want to try to make that possible for more kids.
But with like the architecture program and the engineering, do they self-select or how does
those are also, the engineering one we're targeting right now just one school because it's a pilot. And then we're going to actually partner with some other community programs, and I can't say who they are yet because we haven't finalized that. And then we'll move it into schools. And so it will. It's very much school dependent, but our goal is to build this curriculum that can be then used in multiple schools. The architecture one targeted 6 schools, and they simply picked 6 schools because then they were at capacity.
But not everybody wants to do architecture,
right.
So I'm wondering, so they just...
Okay. Oh, within those 6 schools, yes,
yeah.
They sign up, yes.
Okay.
Sure. Yes. Mm-hmm. And the same with the engineering program. We made a pitch to kids, and then they signed up. Most of the schools actually have enrichment credit requirements, and so many times the kids are motivated to sign up because of those enrichment credits. Other questions?
So the 6 schools that you mentioned, are they right now the only ones that are involved with any of the programs, or are there just ones involved with
the architecture, just the architecture one. And that was mainly a matter of we have to start somewhere, and again, capacity issues. And that's why the idea of building an alliance, because, you know, we're one institution, we can only do so much, but if we all work together, then we can expand our reach. Yes?
Operationally, how do you make that pitch to these kids and schools? I'm not trying to get really drilled down at the same time. When you're trying to make a presentation to schools, to students who may not really have much of an idea of what this is all about. We're kind of facing sort of the same things in Lansing. I'm just trying to get an idea of what you're. So what do you do? You have a group come in, a team come in, do you bring them in small groups? You do a large group for your presentation?
We do all of those things. I should just say yes. We do all of those things. We talk to classes of kids. We really targeted 9th grade to start with the sensors program, and then also opened it to 8th grade because there's something about that that transition and that bubble. We got a lot of 8th graders who were really interested. One thing that is challenging in some schools, and this speaks to my point about we're all stepping on each other, is that 9th graders seem to have a lot more activities. They already were at capacity themselves. And so the 8th graders had more space in their afternoon.
I'm still aware of the 9th graders a little bit too, so they're kind of figuring out how they're going to move into that transition. Yeah.
Right, exactly. You know, what we know about development is that the earlier you can start working with children, infants, really, to start thinking about and learning some of these different kinds of skills, the better. That does not mean that we should stop once we do some work at early childhood. So I'm an adolescence person, and I want to make a pitch against putting all of our resources focusing on early childhood. You don't build a foundation of a house and then walk away and leave it and live on the top of your basement. You build the rest of the house and you maintain it, and we need to do that for young people. So, but we do need to start early, very, very early. Yes.
Are there any other cities in Michigan studying this and starting some of this?
There are other places where people are doing this kind of work. We have a number of efforts actually in Grand Rapids around early literacy and mathematics education and teacher education. In fact, little pitch. We're going to be doing a community seminar in Grand Rapids on May 3rd. I think it'll be around 4:30, 5 o'clock. I can send the information to Veronica, and then we'll get it out to everyone. If you're from the west side of the state, Deborah Ball is going to talk about the partnership she has with in teacher education and math teacher education in particular. Really focused on elementary math, and then Nell Duke will talk about early literacy education.
Yes. Hi. I am a graduate of Renaissance High School in Detroit, and I just know for over the many decades, by how many, more than three, that there's always been really great programs in Detroit. There's always been accelerated programs, there's always been specific focus programs in different disciplines. In a different time and place, a lot of those were funded by the state, and since they've been defunded by the state, a lot. It's great that the universities and philanthropic organizations have kicked in to support a lot of the supporting programs. But I was kind of intrigued that in your alliances, Detroit is very political, and I didn't see any alliances with city council, for example. I mean, because a lot of what happens, also Detroit is very insular in a lot of respects. And so to really get things moving, you have to be connected to those people who have the attention of the people. And with that, I also didn't see any churches or groups, which are highly influential in getting the youth involved in things. So I would just kind of suggest maybe seek some alliances in those places, because they're really going to impact the children of the people involved in those processes.
You're absolutely right, and actually it's a really good point on this circle to add. I suppose, you know, we would think of churches as part of cultural organizations, but I think it would be good to actually have a call out.
There's some huge entities, and they have their own programs, but to know, let their students know what's available in a larger sense is great. Another point I'd like to mention, I also am a graduate of the College of Education from Michigan State, and in a program that I was a part of, they sent new teachers, you know, as part of a scholarship program, new teachers are sent to Detroit Public Schools to teach. Mm-hmm. These teachers are coming out of Michigan State, has the number one K-12 college of education, 15 years running. Mm-hmm. And so,
it's
you know,
23 years.
Okay, I am behind. But it's still the fact that it's number one. But anyway, the reason I mentioned that is not to brag. The point is, you're getting the best prepared teachers with the best new and innovative ideas that were sent to Detroit Public Schools. Because of their scholarship, they had to give them 2 years, and a lot of them wanted to stay. They're excited, they're enthralled, they're just into it, they're trying to implement new and innovative ideas, and then what happens? Budget issues happen, and the first people to go are the newest teachers hired. So all of that innovation, all of that creativity, everything that enriches all of the curriculum and everything you mentioned goes away.
Yep.
So part of it also I would endeavor is some policy problems in there, because they're constantly, you know, research has shown it's the constant battle between, you know, is it the teachers or is it the students? What's the problem here? But these students, these young teachers were eager and just ready to get out there and work with the students, and it didn't bother them in any way that it was urban education, and they saw it as a challenge. But then systematically, over the years that I was involved with the program, the first ones to go were the last ones in. And
that's
so
right.
That's the problem, because that cuts off that innovation.
And that's exactly what I mean by we need ambitious and systemic leadership. We can't have leadership that's rotating through, because then that leads to teachers who are rotating through. And you're absolutely right. And this makes a great example of that. So this young woman was a teacher in Detroit. She was a student in our program. And this is the last bit of alliance that I want to tell you about. But I'm not going to tell you about it. I'm going to have, if this works, I'm going to have some other people tell you about it. So let's see if it works. So this represents our clinical rounds project in secondary.
Paid $100 to buy that stock, so how much money did you lose?
Teaching our teachers, the University of Michigan has a different approach to get its students ready for the classroom.
Simply knowing your content would never make you an effective teacher.
Teachers have such an important job educating our children, preparing them for college and the working world.
And U of M School of Education created the Rounds Project, revamping how it teaches its teachers, modeling it off a program used to train doctors. Rhonda Walker explains how this works in this Education Nation report.
The University of Michigan is exposing its teaching interns to different classrooms and schools, helping them develop their teaching style and helping them decide where they want to teach.
Banking crisis group. What is the banking crisis?
A couple minutes in Amelia Gurnan's class at the Detroit Institute of Technology, and it's easy to see she is passionate about teaching history.
The Great Depression, guys, had this massive domino effect.
Amelia learned how to teach through the Rounds Project at the University of Michigan. Now she's passing her skills onto U of M's current teaching interns.
Student interns do rounds through schools and through different classrooms in preparation for their student teaching semester.
What about loans? Can you get loans?
Much like medical interns make rounds at hospitals, the teaching interns do rotations at three different middle and high schools, working with attending teachers.
We decided that we would identify three attending teachers, three teachers in the field who did the kinds of things that we were teaching in our courses.
During each rotation, the interns focus on different teaching skills, selecting and using text, assessing students, planning lessons, and teaching them.
It was really beneficial to be able to observe a lot of different teachers and gain their best practices before I went into student teaching.
It's just great to like see all these different environments and how these teachers work.
Just as doctors intervene while medical interns are teaching patients, these attending teachers are also expected to step in during a lesson.
They've had to learn how to intervene without making the interns feel terrible, but intervene in a way that actually models for them really great instruction.
The Rounds Project was developed by Elizabeth Bermoji and Robert Bain at the U of M. It began with social studies teaching interns, but has been expanded this year to include math and English language arts.
But you paid $100 to buy that stock, so how much money did you lose?
The university also developed a handover system as these interns rotate in and out of classes.
Just as a doctor or a nurse wouldn't leave a shift with a patient without making some notes, we don't want our students to leave the shift, the rotation, without making some notes. The value of finding out who your students are, how the classroom works before you enter it, we think is quite powerful.
Elizabeth says faculty also adopted a system to hand over information about the interns as they move through the teaching program. She believes that's been one of the most important changes.
The way we're working together across all semesters of our program and all courses within a semester, and trying to do a better job of connecting to the coursework.
What happens if all of a sudden Google stock falls to $40?
Because it's all about being an effective teacher. Simply knowing your content would never make you an effective teacher. You need to know the practical skills for how to reach students.
A product of the Rounds Project, Amelia appears to be making an impact.
She has been one of like the most exciting social studies teachers I've had so far.
The University of Michigan would like to expand their program one day to offer support to teachers during the first few years of their careers. I'm Rhonda Walker, back to you.
Well, the university says the program has more students wanting to teach in urban schools because they see an opportunity to make a difference. So for more on the Rounds Project.
And that ties to your point, because that young woman who was teaching, she was one of our students, became an attending teacher in our program, mentored new young teachers. She no longer teaches there. And it's part of a pretty big fiasco that occurred that led to her leaving because her leader was taken out of the job and, you know, the dominoes fall.
So these young people who stay now, they want to teach in these settings, are in fact discouraged from teaching in those settings, and sometimes are actually discouraged from even getting hired. Like, they're applying and they can't get hired. That is going to change. I'm confident that that is going to change. But that's why the more we build the alliances, the better chance we'll have for building something that's sustained and that makes a space that teachers feel supported.
And the alliance is important. I just would ask that in your alliance include more of the groups within the community that will have the right amount of influence over decision makers so that that innovation can stick.
Absolutely. And as you see, this is the goal. Right? We want government, we want funders, we work closely with Stillman and Kresge and all of those institutions. We're doing that. These were just the list of people we've been working with, but you're absolutely right. And I love the idea about working more deliberately with churches, because I think that's just such a central cultural group in Detroit. So, thank you. Now, I saw some other hands.
I'm cool.
You're cool. And that is really the end of my formal presentation, except to say that, you know, Detroit is making a comeback economically. There is a really strong revitalization at work, but I'm convinced it will not last if we don't educate the future citizens. They are the future. I know I sound like Whitney Houston or something, but you know, if we don't attend to teaching and learning and leadership, and if we don't work together to do it, I think then we do have cause for losing hope. But I haven't lost hope. I think we can do this, but I think it will take an alliance. Yes and yes.
Let her go.
Oh.
So if you're a parent of a child in Detroit, how do you find out about this program?
That is a great question, and I don't have the answer to that. I think most of the time parents find out through the school, because the kids have to sign permission slips, or have to pass permission slips. So those get distributed, but do they get distributed equitably? Do they take them home? As a researcher of adolescents, I had to follow kids to their lockers to get those permission slips, and it's crumpled up in a book somewhere. Actually, I don't know how that, I know what we do, how it currently happens in our programs, but to me that even makes a stronger case for more of an alliance. If we had something that was identified and identifiable, parents would know where to come, where to ask questions. We could have, you know, units that actually would distribute information to parents and be there for them to guide them. You know, what's the best program? It's not necessarily the best, you know, because it's, I'm going to use FIRST Robotics again because it's very popular. FIRST Robotics is great, but not for every child. And so having some kind of system for getting kids into those programs would be wonderful. Yes?
All the programs you're talking about, the one thing I didn't hear is how the bioenergetics of the body, the health, the biology of the body. It's a very, you are like set up like a drone. They are actually building robots that resemble people who are, but they're not teaching that. We are on the alternative health world too. So there are frequencies that can be studied and taught about the body. I mean, everybody believes in a cell phone, that they take this little thing, put it up to the ear, and they can hear grandma on the other side of the country.
Yeah.
You believe that, but there's a frequency and an energy line that is, and that all happens in our body responds to that. But they're not talking or teaching this in our schools, period.
Well, I think we do have a number of different partnerships with Michigan Medicine, and I know all of the other institutions also do work with medical education. Whether they're doing bioengineering, they're not there yet. But there are a number of different programs and a number of different schools. I didn't mention that we also work with public charters. So we work with traditional public schools and public charters, and a number of public charters have relationships
direct relationships with Oakwood and Beaumont and Michigan Medicine.
They're not there either.
Well, I can't say for sure, because I don't know actually the lay of the land. There are so many programs out there for young people, but they're not necessarily in school, you're right.
How about talking about teaching this to our kids? Because that's what we got to teach, is the kids, because the old guys are just going to wait out their retirement, excuse me. Okay, and that's, well, come on. Why, you got teachers of tenure. They don't really care. They're putting their time in. They keep them, and the young kids are put out.
I think there are a lot of fabulous veteran teachers, and we need to hold on to them and prize them because they're fabulous. Yeah, they're. I don't think we can say that uniformly. It's not all.
Well, nothing's uniformly. I apologize to everybody. But these young kids need to learn this stuff because Europe's got it.
Right.
Why doesn't the U.S.?
Well, we are teaching engineering education. You know, it's in the standards. So it's now something we're working on. I actually, in my center project, I have a former engineer who is getting her PhD in education, and she's working with the kids directly, which is one way, by the way, that we get kids, because we have these young people, you know, doing the work with them. They don't want the old people anymore, like me. But that, you know, we're working on it. We're getting there.
Robotics is big.
Robotics is huge, yeah. Absolutely. Yes.
Getting back to the sensor program, when a class is involved in one of these projects, how does that get advertised in some way?
It does.
I don't live in the Detroit area, so I wouldn't see what's in the news. At one point, I lived in Monroe, and I would see the news from Detroit, and you would think you couldn't walk out your door without being shot.
That is absolutely
so
right.
So, you know, I think more positive news about what's going on in education might make people make more positive success.
I think you're absolutely right, and that could be another outgrowth. Just like parents would learn more about the opportunities for their students, we would be able to reframe how people talk about Detroit and other cities around the state, Flint, Grand Rapids, you know, all of Benton Harbor, all the cities that are facing some of these challenges. So you're absolutely right. The alliance would allow us to do that more effectively.
And if it got into the news that the classes were helping, then that would let other people know the classes did that. How can my kid get into that class?
That's exactly right. So we're going to be doing another community seminar. So this is part of my mission to be better public scholars. So we're, and you're all invited, we're doing a seminar on April 24th. It will be in Detroit at the Jam Handy, if you're familiar with that. And again, I can send that information out. This will feature Matt Lister, who is an architect and urban planner. But he's working on our sensors project, and he's training the kids in collecting data face-to-face. So going into parks and actually checking, you know, how many people walked through the park, how old were they? And he's going to talk about measuring and documenting public life. So you're welcome to come to that. And at that, we're going to make sure everybody learns about sensors in a shoebox. And we're going to actually videotape him, video record. We don't tape anymore. Video record him the day before working with the young people. So there's our first step to try to advertise this. But you know, until we get the alliance really built, we won't be able to advertise this effectively. I saw a couple different hands. Yes, you have asked a question.
I was wondering what you think the educational system, how it could be changed or improved to let young people know about the new careers of, you know, 2017 going forward, that, you know, so many people are struggling to earn a decent income, so they need to reinvent everybody's notion of what the jobs of today and the future.
Right. Well, I do think some of that work can be done in classrooms. I think that teachers can be encouraged to bring more people into classrooms to speak about their careers, and not the, you know, bring your parents for career day kind of thing, but doing things like we're doing with Matt Lister, who is very, you know, hip and cool and does this amazing, interesting work and shows people, young people, how urban planners don't just make a plan, they actually have to understand what people want in the city. You know, that kind of work, I think, is really powerful. That's why we're bringing him into contact with the kids. I think working with universities, I just want to emphasize the value of university partnerships and the rich resource that all of our communities have basically right in their neighborhoods. I mean, there are so many different universities in this state, and school districts don't work with them as fully as they could. Because university students are at the cutting edge, and I'll tell you, on our campus, and you probably would concur, these young people want to do something for the community. They love working with kids. They'd be out working with kids all the time if they could. And so we need to encourage schools to make use of this resource. We had, at Detroit School of Arts, we had young people from MPOW, which is the musical theater group on campus, Michigan and I program and something, arts, come out and work with our kids in our theater program at Detroit School of Arts on getting ready for auditions. And these young women, when they came to meet with us to plan this, they were intimidating to me. They were amazing. I mean, this is the program that produced Darren Criss and, you know, people like that, Lucy Liu. I mean, this is the best musical theater program in the nation, and they went out and worked with our kids to work on preparing for auditions. That's the kind of thing we need to do more of. I know those aren't the kinds of careers necessarily that you're thinking of, but these kids want to do it.
And how are you going to measure success?
How are we going to measure success? So you saw the outcomes thing in the four boxes. We measure success in a variety of ways. First of all, can we get more kids into the program? Right? So reach, are we actually connecting with kids? Long term, we want to look at staying in school. We want to look at graduation rates. We want to look at grades, because grades matter. People think it's all test scores, but grades tell colleges and employers about effort and perseverance. We want to look at test scores. They are an important indicator. They're one indicator. We want the kids building portfolios. And we want to see, especially in our census project, kids presenting and, you know, to city councils, that's why the government piece is so important, to the mayor's office, to other community organizations. And we want to see them making change. And that would be a key piece of success. And then finally, we want to measure engagement, motivation, identity, sense of agency, because it's one thing to get a great test score, it's another to feel like you can actually make a difference in your community. So those would be the whole range of measurements that we would employ. If we think about the alliance, I can see the background, I know it's time to stop. The alliance, with the way to measure success, is, are we seen as a group? Are we seen as a comprehensive or a collective versus Michigan State's doing this, Eastern's doing that, Detroit Future City's doing something different? That will be a more ephemeral kind of measurement. But if someday we're all back together and we talk about idea or whatever label we give it as just a de facto kind of thing, it's like it's a practicing organization, we all recognize it, that will be our measure of success.
Thank you.
Please join me in thanking Vinnie Elizabeth Moje. Thank you. This was just very, very helpful for all of us on every level, and it makes a lot of us want to jump in. Volume 2 continue to help innovate our schools in urban settings, particularly in Detroit. Dean Moje, on behalf of the UM Office of Government Relations and Alumni Association, would like to present this Wolverine Caucus pen.
Ooh, it's so pretty.
Go on this side.
And I'd like
like to point out that we coordinated our blue lace and black outfits. Thank you so much. Thank you all for staying.
I got the dudes in the room. So thank you again for coming.
I see it being filmed.
Today's session was filmed, and we do have a PowerPoint available, and I believe the Moje would be open to all of you having a copy to let us know.
And my email address, if you don't mind.
Absolutely.
Oh, I actually have it. I guess I did have another slide. This is our school website, and my email address is just moje@umich.edu. And I want to build an alliance, so please reach out.
Please do reach out to the Moje. And again, as you know, our forums are sponsored by the Office of the Vice President for Government Relations and the UM Alumni Association. So we invite you back again on April 18th, where we'll be talking about Michigan athletics. So with that, we wish you an excellent spring.
If more people go to that session than came to this one, I want you to call me.
Who is it?
I'm sure.
Is it work?
We have someone who works with our athletic director. His name is Jeff Porter, and he is a UM volunteer.